Welcome to the episode of Green Pastures. We are here today to discuss about conveying the sanctity of marriage in this age of casual, calculated relationships. We have a wonderful panel here.
I'm Raymond David from Kolkata, married, and I have three lovely children. I belong to Alidio Velankani, Picnic Garden, Kolkata.
I'm Rani Tarakan from Cochin. I'm married. And I'm a housewife.
Hi, I'm Mata Antao from Goa, and I'm working for a property management company.
I'm Ruth Greenwood from Chennai. I work as a teacher, and he's my husband.
Hi, I'm Sheldon Greenwood, and I'm from Chennai, and I work as a delivery manager in a book conversion company.
Hi, Raymond. Do you want to share your thoughts on this topic?
My experience going around seeing the youth today, those who are going to get married, I find there is no sanctity. In fact, I have seen that just after marriage, after 2 days, they have had a fight. And that too, very big fight. And then also I have heard they got married, and the very day of the night of the marriage, that person wanted to go home. I tell you the truth, 5 years back I heard the vicar general, who's tribunal for marriage, he turned around and told us that there was divorce cases in the church. There was 92 divorce cases in the church, and he told us last year there were more than 1,027 like that divorce cases coming to the church now for annulment. So where's the sanctity? I think so today our mindset, our thinking for the way this world is moving, we are all on, we are all on a platform where everything is speed and fast. Everything is on like a fast food. When I got married, I felt it was so lovely. I was looking forward. And I was so joyful. My wife was extra joyful. And we lived, in spite of not knowing God so much, not knowing Jesus so much, we found the company of one another so lovely, so wonderful. But today I find something else. They are looking out for something besides the real sanctity, as we are discussing sanctity where marriage is concerned.
Rani, what do you think, what the youngsters can do to change this nowadays?
One is, life is very stressful. So one needs to, now after many years of marriage, I feel now one should bring in some form of a prayer, some kind of a communication between each other and understanding between each other, rather than trying to compete with each other. Because today, more women are being educated and working, so there's always a competition between them. So I feel they need an understanding and some kind of communication, understanding, to find their own balance and a little bit of give and take, not to make issues about everything.
So we make prayer as the main
A little bit
focus.
Of prayer, because when we started our marriage, we didn't have so much of prayer, but there was a lot of give and take. And you don't make issues out of everything. You have to be a listener to be able to understand. If marriage, first and foremost, we need to know whether marriage is important to you. If marriage is important to you, then you have to work towards a kind of a understanding to see where you are going wrong, to be able to find a solution to it, rather than just drop it and go, which most people are doing today.
Right. So basically we are trying to say is marriage is one time and there's no option.
Yes.
It's like marriage is forever.
Yeah, that's what I believe in. So I believe that, and that's what I tell my children.
Right, yeah, thank you. Sheldon, what do you think?
For me, marriage is going into battle, and you have to go into battle as a team, your wife, yourself, and with God. I mean, if basically before getting married, a person gets to understand that, sanctity would come in naturally. they should probably have the fear of God in them before they get into marriage. In fights, definitely, mean even if you're going to tell them have God in them and, you know, start your marriage after that as well. Definitely, there are going to be stages in the life where you're going to have fights. It all depends on every individual. One person has to give in to the other at that particular time. And basically, it's your personal decision, and it's your understanding that marriage is not your choice. It's God's choice, rather. And it's not a choice, it's like a covenant. That's according to me for marriage. And I mean, how we show it in our lives is basically being happy with each other. I can't go and tell another younger couple, to tell them this is what you do in marriage. Probably our own lives, the way we live, is going to be best examples, what I feel, Mata.
Ruth?
For me, marriage is a blessing. As Sheldon said, we have to give in. We have to sacrifice a lot of things. That's what I learned from this marriage. When I got married to Sheldon, it was like, okay, life is going to be a magical world and all that. But after I got married, like, basically, I was not so close to God. I was like, my mom was very spiritual, but my dad, being a police officer, he didn't have time to go to to church. And same way, I was like, usually only once in a month to Sunday Mass, I'll go. But when I got married to Sheldon, my in-laws are very spiritual. And once we got married, they made sure that we must make a retreat to Bota. We must come here. And I was like, I don't want to go because I don't want to say praise you, Jesus, hallelujah. I don't want, because that's not what, if really you love God, it's deep inside you. You don't have to show by raising your hand and praising God. And I was very angry. And we used to have a lot of fights also, but always Sheldon will be the first person to give in. He'll say, leave it, don't worry, it's God's plan. God only brought us together. And even if I go in anger to sleep, Sheldon will be always there. Okay, forgive, let's pray, don't worry. Like, he was always pacifying me in a lovely manner, but I used to get very frustrated. And then slowly the journey started with God. And when I came to Pota, like, I experienced something good. But not that much. And the second time was in 2013 when I came for the second time to Pota. And that time again I felt a little spiritual power, like God is telling me to do something, like I have to understand what the others are telling. I used to get angry with my in-laws, like I don't want to sit for the family prayer, I don't want to, because I have a lot of work, I have this correction, that correction, I don't have time for all these things. But still, my in-laws, they didn't give in. They were like, come Ruth, we will sit, we'll pray, God will definitely find a solution. And every time they'll very beautifully, very coolly they'll tell, and my father-in-law will always say some verse or the other from the Bible. And then last year we joined a prayer group. Sheldon was a part of a prayer group when he was studying in college. And after they got married, they always got separated, working in different parts of the countries. And then they came together and they said, let's form a group. And now we are called as Reconnect. Our wow. prayer group is called as Reconnect. That's the blessing which I got. Like, when we come as a prayer group members, like, and we have that fellowship together, that spiritual part of me started like firing, like a fire, it came up. I became a little calm. I stopped shouting at them. I started listening to their words. And my father-in-law started telling some words. I was like, okay. And I started throwing questions also. What if this happens like this? What Bible says like this? Everything started. And I came more closer to God last year in the month of August, actually, I'll say. That was the encounter, I'll say. And then I think that made me more closer to God, because I started sitting with my in-laws, started praying together, telling rosaries, and everything started, the journey. It changed my life. And then I started realizing, definitely it's a God's plan that God brought us together and gave me such a lovely in-laws who didn't get angry at all. They were with me, they were praying, they were telling Ruth, everything will be all right. It's really different. It's just a blessing that we both came together. There were times when we really fight a lot. And now I started realizing it's my turn that I should sacrifice, I should give in, I should ask sorry, I should like be a little polite even if Sheldon comes, because now his job has got a little stressful. Okay. So I understood that it's my turn, that I should understand, I should calm down myself and start listening to him and start loving him more. Though he shouts, I have to lend my ears. That's what happens in the couples, right? Once one starts shouting, the other also. So it's like boom, boom, boom. And then you realize. So now I'm really happy, praise God. I understood everything, what life is all about. It is not a bed of roses. There are thorns too, but we should know how we have to cross it or pick it up and throw it in the dustbin.
So you're blessed with good in-laws.
Definitely, I'll say.
The focus was mainly on family prayer, but
exactly.
That changed your life and coming here. Any suggestions for the youngsters, Raymond?
I'll tell you very frankly. Very frankly, my experience, we stopped praying in the house for the last 1 year. And I found there was a lot of fights with my wife in spite of being married 35 years. Then I realized in my house I have to lead all the prayers. So I took it this way. Why should I lead the prayers all the time? So prayers stopped in the house. And we found that my wife would get, she's not a person like that, but she would get angry and she would show her tantrums, which she would not show before. And then I would start getting angry for any little thing. So I was wondering what is going on. I said, there's something wrong here. I go to church. I pray very well. I read the Word of God sometimes. But it is not on a regular basis. And I found all these problems taking place very often. Maybe in a weekly basis. Or even almost 2-3 times a day. Then I realized that something is wrong. Then I tried to start prayers, but it is not happening. Either just during the prayer time, my daughter will get up or my wife will get up, or the phone will ring and we will stop the prayers, give importance to so many things. Then we decided that something must be done. So we planned that we'll come to Divine Retreat Center. And I realized that we need to get back to prayer. And once we came here, I am more loving to my wife, and I'm finding my wife, she's asking me for pardon, sorry, and all that. And I have also got back into that mode of praying and loving. Now I can experience once again, as you say, I'm newly married now. This is the experience. Now I realize we need to walk with the Lord, not as I was doing earlier, but we need to walk with the Lord.
Sometimes we just think going for Mass every Sunday and we come back and, you know, that's what Catholic faith, that's what we were taught, like, okay, go for Sunday Mass, we come back. But there's no basically reading the Word of God. I've been married for 28 years. I've got 2 kids. This is my first time at Pota and I'm loving it. I mean, I'm going so joyfully, so blessed. And I would want my kids to come here, attend the retreat, so they know the importance of the Word of God and they start reading it and they know the teachings of our Lord. What is your take on this?
From what I've understood is unless we start from when the children are very young, only then does it make an impression on them.
Yes.
And the other thing is, so it has to be part of our family life. They have to grow up with this. And the other thing that I understood, though I've been for several retreats, only yesterday it made a kind of an impression on my mind that your partner is a gift from God, whether good or bad. And you have to learn to take it in your stride and accept it and without complaints, and learn to do what you have to do to make your marriage work. So for that, you need something, you need a grace from above.
Yes.
A deep infilling of the Holy Spirit. You need that grace to make it work. And that is what I understood after so many years of marriage.
And this grace you get with family prayer, praying together.
Family prayer, all that is there. But then unless you can accept your partner the way he is.
Yes.
And for that, it is that you have to accept it as a gift from God, is what I understood only yesterday at the retreat. And so you can accept him with all his shortcomings, and negative, positive and negative, and take it in your stride and pray for the grace to make it work. But I don't know, I mean, with the youth, it depends if they get that, unless they come for these retreats. I feel changes happened in my life was when I came into the charismatic renewal. It's been a slow process, but that's helped me change and look at life differently. And I feel your children also they have to be exposed to this. And that's the only way I feel they can bring in the sanctity and maybe whatever happens in your own home.
I think you've been very blessed, Ruth, having your in-laws supporting you all the time in prayers.
Definitely.
Yeah.
We need the blessings of our elderly people at home.
Especially the support with prayers. They understood you when you didn't want to go for prayers. They were there with you, praying, supporting you all the while.
They didn't get angry. That also made me realize how they are so blessed, not getting angry, and so coolly, so smoothly they are speaking, and they... they didn't fight back. They were like, okay, Ruth, come, we will pray. And that made me to come at last closer to God.
So they have been a very strong family. They have coming from a very...
Definitely. My father-in-law used to say that he had a lot of bad habits when he got married. He was into a lot of things. And then when he came to Pota, he changed totally. And he keeps telling me that every time. I said, really, did it happen? Sometimes I really used to wonder, okay, you're just telling a story or blabbering something. No, but really, he got an experience and he keeps sharing. Though he would have shared that more than 50 times. But still, even I see him doing the same thing in our parish. Like doing the work, being 60 years old. He does all the electrical work and all this, going, helping. He's in this Vincent de Paul. And you learn from him. In spite of working, you have to take time to go and help someone. He gives counseling also to the other couples. So I have learned a lot. And really, we must be with our in-laws, I'll say. Because there are youngsters nowadays who wants to get married and say that let us go separately and live separately. No need for the parents and the in-laws. Yeah.
And I think this is the reason you have the conflict only among these two, and there's nobody to actually support or advise you on what's actually right or wrong.
Even if you say there's divorce cases which is coming up, I think they must be living separately. So there is no one to counsel them. It's only like cats and dogs fighting. So you lose of words, and which hurts them and everything. But when an elderly person is at home, there is someone to counsel you. Even when we used to fight, my mother-in-law will come no, it's okay, Ruth, don't worry. I know even he would not have done mistake. Sheldon would not have done. But she'll support me saying, it's okay, Ruth, Sheldon has done something, forgive him, no problem. And the same way she'll also advise him. So really it's a blessing to have elderly people at home. Otherwise, definitely, the way we used to fight every night, there will be something or the other, okay, auntie said like this, uncle said like this, I don't want to live, and I was happy in my house. But definitely, it's a prayer.
How was it looking at your in-laws so close to each other? I mean, were you impressed with them? Or,
definitely,
you know, especially
really
prayers that has brought them together?
It's a blessing that I'm into this family. As Jeremiah 29 verse 11 says, God has a plan.
Yes.
I have accepted this as my plan. And today also when we are sitting here, this is a plan that we have to go as a couple to Chennai and talk about Jesus, about all the miracles to those couples, so that it will be a blessing for them also to come back and experience the same thing what I have experienced.
Good. We're wishing you all the best, Ruth.
Thank you,
Sheldon.
So much.
Before you speak to the youngsters, I just feel you need to pray for them. Find out what
yes.
their what they're going through, and only then you tell them what you feel you need to tell them.
We need to keep them in prayers.
Yeah, and then you tell them it might make sense to you, but trying to be forcefully trying them, getting them to do anything, it doesn't work. If you say yes, they will definitely say no. So I just personally feel you just walk in, you just take it in your stride and look at the youngsters, see what they are going through, see what their background was, how did they come up, you know, and through that you help them in whichever way you can.
You wanted to say something?
What I feel is our children, the youth, they need something more. Today in this mad world, where everything, as I told you, is moving so fast, our youth is simply drawn towards the gadgets that are available today for them and the crazy the work they are doing. They are simply stressed out. You give them advice, they take it from one ear and goes out from the other ear.
Then what would you suggest?
So I suggest that our Catholic youth or youngsters should be exposed to the renewal, like how we are facing the renewal that is taking place in Divine Retreat Center. This is a beautiful retreat. This is not my first retreat, but each time I come here, I get renewed. I feel strengthened. I feel the love of God. And I go out back to my parish, and there I interact. And this time, I tell you, 20 people I have brought from my parish, like anybody, but without much of godliness. They are of the world. But after coming here, many of them have realized. So I feel today the church should be exposed to the renewal, like how they are having in Divine Retreat Center. I think so. Many places should be having this.
So you're saying that every church should have something for the youngsters.
Yeah, should be having a couples retreat in our parish. Our children also should go through that experience before marriage. They should have when they are having marriage preparation course, they should go through a retreat, like the ones that we are having here in Divine Retreat Center. Something our church should do. We people, not only the church, not only the priest, like we the laity of the church. Now, for example, we in the panel here, when we go back, we should form maybe a group of people like-minded for the glory of God, that our people start experiencing God once again in their life. It is not only prayers. Parents have been praying for their children earlier also, but today it is not having much effect on our children. Now, today our children must experience God in their life. As y'all, yes. Y'all have it's an example with you.
Yes.
Huh? What happened? Because you met such a guy, such a family, and now you're experiencing, and you come here because of the experience of your father-in-law. And now you are so joyful, you're smiling.
So as we see, Ruth, you would agree with me that it's always good to have your in-laws. You need to have elderly people around.
Definitely.
So you get the advice, especially for the initial first few years.
Yes.
And that's what you have experienced.
Definitely.
If
I
not for
be
them,
an example.
Yes, if not for them, I don't think your marriage would be as strong as it is
definitely,
today.
Definitely, I agree with that.
Yeah. As Rani said, marriages are made in heaven. I believe too that marriages are made in heaven and the partner is chosen by God. And once we understand that the partner is from God, I think way to look differently. I mean, you look at things differently. Raymond, as you said, that we need to have retreats for couples in all churches. Let's pray for it, and I hope it starts soon. Thank you for joining us today, and wishing you all the best, and God bless you.